I could have your attention, please. If I could have your attention, please. Thank you. I greet you with the greeting of peace, the greeting of the prophets. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May the peace and blessings of God be upon you all. I want to extend a warm welcome on behalf of the East Plano Islamic Center to all of you here today. My name is Sayyid Ahmed. I'm a volunteer with the Outreach Committee. I think some of you have probably seen the agenda that's on the tables. We have the most important part of the agenda first, which is the food. Right? So it's just designed that way. The actual program will be starting around 12:50, but we do want to get people in line to get their food first. So any of you who have been to Muslim gatherings in the past know that all Muslim gatherings, including inaugurations, begin with the recitation of the Quran. That includes praising of God, thanking of God, and much more. So we will be having Hafiz Sajjad Gul, who is the one of the imams here at EPIC, reciting Quran. And then the translation will be done by Hannah Ishaq, and I'll say a few words about them afterwards.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآتى المال على حبه ذوي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائلين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآتى الزكاة والموفون بعهدهم إذا عاهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون
السلام عليكم
Okay. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Is it on?
Okay, there we go. Assalamu alaikum.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. All praise and thanks be to Allah, the Lord of the world, the only owner of the Day of Judgment. You alone we worship, and you alone we ask for help. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those on whom you have bestowed your grace, and not of those who earned your anger. Righteousness is not that you turn your face towards the east or the west, but righteousness is one who believes in Allah, the last day, the angels, the book, and the prophets, and gives wealth in spite of love for it to relatives, to orphans, the needy, the traveler, those who ask, and for freeing slaves. They establish prayer and give charity and fulfill their promises. They are patient in poverty, hardship, and battle. Those are the ones who have been true, and it is those who are the righteous. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Hannah, and thank you, Hafiz Sajjad. Just to give you a little bit of quick background, Hafiz Sajjad is a beloved imam here, right here at EPIC. To give you background, he has actually memorized the whole Quran from end to end. That means 6,236 verses. We're very blessed to have him here. He's also trained a number of students who have also memorized the Quran from end to end. You know, it's quite miraculous when you consider that there are actually hundreds and thousands of Muslims throughout the world who have memorized this book from end to end. He also leads a Quranic school right here at EPIC. Hannah Ishaq, who just read the translation, she's a volunteer here at EPIC. She goes to UTD. You can thank her for the cakes outside. She's also a very talented cake baker. And she happens to be my neighbor too, so I had to involve her in the program. All right. So just to move along with the program, I wanted to give you a little bit of more background regarding this event, and after I'll just take a couple of minutes, and after that, Mr. Khalil Malik, who is the Vice President of the East Plain Islamic Center, will also address you for a couple of minutes. But just to give you a little bit of background, I wanted to clarify, first of all, that this particular event is not an inauguration in the sense that it's the first time we're doing it. We did have an opening of this mosque or this facility last Ramadan, several months ago, for our members. And since then, we've had a number of different people of other faiths, different groups who have come in. But this is the first time we're having a public inauguration for the whole community at large. So it really is an auspicious occasion, and we honestly are very happy to have you here with us and partake in it. We know it's not easy to take time out of your busy schedules and in many cases out of your family time to be here, but hopefully it was worth it, and hopefully the food was worth it at the very least, right? And we'll try to make the rest of the program worthwhile. But again, just to give you additional background on the event, the theme of this particular event, as you see on the banner behind me, says opening new doors, building new bridges. When we were thinking about that slogan, we realized that it's not just a slogan, but it is something that really is and truly is a critical part of our faith. And what do I mean by that? For example, kindness and generosity to our guests and to our neighbors is actually part and parcel of our very faith. To give you a few examples, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, advised us more than 1400 years ago that whoever believes in God and the hereafter, let him honor his neighbor. Whoever believes in God and the hereafter, let him honor his guest as he is entitled to be. He also reminded us of the golden rule that none of you truly believes or has complete faith until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. In another similar narration, he also said, none of you truly believes until he loves for his neighbor what he loves for himself. So again, this is part and parcel of our faith, and he never distinguished between Muslim or non-Muslim neighbors. It's regardless of who that person is. Similarly, all of this is not just theoretical. There was an incident during the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, where he once asked a companion of his named Abu Talha to take home a guest who happened to be a traveler at the time. The companion was a very simple man who had a wife named Umm Sulaim and a few kids. When he took his guest home, he spoke to his wife, and suddenly he realized they only had enough food for basically one person. So it was an awkward moment, but you know, this is more than 1400 years ago and they had lanterns, they didn't have all this beautiful lighting and so forth. So what he did was he told his wife to dim the lanterns so that it became so dark that his guests couldn't even see what was going on. He made sure that his guests fully ate while he and his wife were basically did not eat, neither did his children. Now this may seem like a very simple act of generosity, but God so loved it that he chose to mention it in a verse in the Quran. So this is just a simple example of generosity and kindness to our guests. There was another very famous incident during the life of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, where a large delegation of Christians had come from a town called Najran to meet the Prophet in Medina. Not only did he greet them very warmly in his own mosque, but he allowed them to pray within that mosque. This was really an amazing example of generosity and religious tolerance and religious diversity that was exemplified over 1400 years ago. So not only did he allow them to pray within his own mosque, he also gave them a place to stay near his own dwelling. And not only that, a few years before this incident, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, also established what is known as the Charter of Medina. The Charter of Medina is something also very important that many historians, including many non-Muslim historians, have called the first written constitution. In this particular document, which was basically an agreement between the Muslims, Christians, Jews, and pagans of that area of Medina, which is part of Saudi Arabia right now, it was an agreement between them that guaranteed in writing religious freedom. It provided security and protection for minorities as well as women. It guaranteed the freedom to own property and appoint judges and included a taxation system and more. It was a truly historic document that today's world could really learn a lot from. Now, I could go on and on, but I just wanted to point out that the sad reality of our times is we live at a time where, you know, such incidents and principles are not considered newsworthy. You know, people who live by such principles are not considered newsworthy. Organizations that promote such principles of peace and tolerance and interfaith harmony are not always considered newsworthy. Instead, we know that a lot of media are focused almost solely on sensational incidents of violence and fear-mongering in some cases. But then again, that's why we have programs like this, right? And that's why we're here, and that's why one of the objectives today is to improve our understanding, even if it's a little bit, of one another. So with that, I'll hand it over to Brother Khalil Malik. He's a good friend of mine. He's the Vice President of EPIC. Here he is.
Thank you, Brother Salahuddin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. That is, may the peace and blessings of God be upon you. On behalf of the East Plano Islamic Center Board of Directors, I also want to extend a hearty welcome to all of you, the local officials, the school administrators, the political candidates, neighbors, and the EPIC community members. It is truly a pleasure to see all of you here today. By the grace of God, EPIC has rapidly extended from a garage in 2004 to now serving over 5,000 members of the community. This vision was set forth by a few of our founders who were visionaries that knew that EPIC would one day not only be an acronym for the East Plano Islamic Center, but an adjective to describe this community, the EPIC community. We have with us today some of those founding fathers. If you are here with us, would you please stand? Thank you so much. And also, once that vision was set, we had a lot of different board members that have come into place since then. And I also would like to ask any of our previous or current board members to also stand, please. So it took a lot of hard work and generous donations from all of our community members to get us to this stage. Alhamdulillah, that is, praise God, we were able to pay in full the construction of this facility, and we are working on the next phases of that vision. EPIC would like to continue to grow its involvement in city programs, interfaith initiatives, and humanitarian efforts. Recently, we had several of our community volunteers assist in the local tornado relief efforts. And we are looking to expand our free medical clinic to help more needy individuals within the community at large. The medical clinic is run by community volunteers, which include community volunteer doctors who volunteer their time and services. We look forward to working with our city and elected officials to continue to make Plano, Richardson, Murphy, Sachse, and surrounding areas a great place to live. Please let us know how we can increase in helping with that effort. Again, thank you, and hope you enjoyed the food, and look forward to getting to know you a lot better.
All right, thank you so much, Brother Khalil. And just to add to what he was saying, we're going to be having a video in a few minutes that's going to elaborate a little further on some of those surfaces that he was talking about. Before I do so, I do want to, however, recognize some of the special or distinguished guests that we do have with us here today. So what I'll do is I'm going to call out some of your names, and if you could please stand, and I'm going to call them out in different groups. So once you stand, then we'll give some collective applause to these groups. So, I just noticed the mayor walked in, so that's good. So, Paul Volker from the Richardson Mayor. We have Chief Gregory Russian from the Plano Police Department, Chief of Plano Police. Ed Drain, the Assistant Chief of Plano Police. Fred Garcia, also from Plano Police Department. We know we're well protected today, right? That's good to know. All right, we have several people from schools also. Is Susanna Milhon here from Wiley School District? Very good. From Otto Middle School, which is nearby here, and we have a number of EPIC students who go there. We have Antoine Spencer, principal of Otto Middle School. Grant Wilson, counselor at Otto Middle School. Kenitra Robertson, dean of students, Otto Middle School. Is Lisa Sudak here from Wiley School District? Oh, she is. She's out there. Yeah, that's good. We caught her just in time, right? Right in time for the food. All right. Is Jonathan Cox here? He's a CPA. Very good to have you. We also have Azhar Aziz. He's the president of the Islamic Society of North America. It's a national organization and one of the oldest Muslim organizations in the U.S. We have Professor Michael Phillips from Collin College, professor of history. You'll be hearing from him in a few minutes also. We have Owais Siddiqui, councilman from Murphy. So you'll be hearing from him as well. We do have a number of other special guests. They're probably thinking right now, did I forget about them? But I haven't. what's happening on March 1st? Yeah, big date, right? So we are happy to have with us a number of people who are running for office. Or we also have some incumbents, but we won't be hearing from any of them, right? Nobody wants to hear from politicians. No, I'm kidding. Some of them aren't laughing, sorry. I shouldn't have said that. Now, what we're going to do is basically I'll call out your name. You'll have basically 30 seconds to not only give us your name, but what office you're running for, or if you're an incumbent. And then just tell us something special about yourself. So basically, we'll take 30 seconds and just go around and introduce some of the candidates. Do we have Adam Bell with us? Very good. You can stand here. I think you could just, you guys hear me? You want to do it from up here? Yeah. You want to do it?
Microphone?
Yeah, go ahead and use. That way we'll catch it. Oh, almost. There you go.
Well, thank you for having me. My name is Adam Bell. I live in Allen, Texas. I'm running for U.S. Congress, 3rd District, and I'm definitely honored to be a part of this. I come from a very diverse religious background, and I find every opportunity to learn more about another religion enlightening, and it gives me the opportunity, if I am elected, to make sure that I am protecting everyone in the county. And making sure that everyone is included and not one small sect or group is ruling everyone. So I appreciate the opportunity again. I look forward to meeting you individually. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have Denise Hamilton?
My name is Denise Hamilton, running for State Rep House District 89. I've lived in this area for over 30 years. This is my district, and I've lived here for over 30 years. So just asking for your vote. Again, Denise Hamilton.
Thank you so much. Nancy Nelson. Is she here? Oh, okay.
Good afternoon. My name is Nancy Nelson. I'm a candidate for House District 66, State Representative. Thank you all for inviting us here today. The theme of my candidacy all along my campaign has been let's work together, and if you are a resident of House District 66, I would very much welcome your vote. If you are not a resident of that district, I would very much welcome your support and volunteer time.
All right, thank you. Karen Jacobs.
Hi, my name is Karen Jacobs. I'm running for Texas House District 66. And I'm very honored that y'all asked us to come here today. We really appreciate the hospitality. My husband and I together, we have 5 children and 4 grandchildren. And the real focus of my campaign is public education and ensuring that all our children have the opportunities that we have had and to make this society better for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. We have Michael Felak.
Yeah. I don't have a very loud voice. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm Michael Felak. I'm running for U.S. Congress, District 3. The thing that I want to talk about, we just moved back from Southeast Asia, and I have an experience there that has always stayed in my head. It was near Christmas. I was walking down the street in Kuala Lumpur, a Muslim country, and they were playing Christmas carols on the main street. And I just wish that we had that openness and diversity and embracing of diversity over here. So that's the message that I want to say. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Ramona Broomfield.
I am Ramona Broomfield. I'm running for Justice of the Peace Judge, Precinct 3-1. I am honored and privileged to be here. My platform is diversity, education, and equality. And everyone who walks into my courtroom will receive a fair hearing without prejudice and undue influence.
All right. Thank you so much. Constable Sammy Knapp.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the invitation. I'm a 40-year law enforcement officer, just a couple months short of 29 with Plano PD. I came with my wife, Kathy, and I'm an incumbent here, but I still would like to have your support.
Thank you so much for coming. Is Carolyn Mobius here? From Plano ISD? Okay. Judge Chuck Ruckel?
Hi, I'm Judge Chuck Ruckel. I'm your elected Justice of Peace in Precinct 3-1, office in Plano. The Epic Center is the heart of our district. I am thrilled to have been invited here and to meet all of you. Many of you I've already know and have dealt with in the past. I am your Republican nominee, or running under the Republican. I'm the Republican judge now, and we got the Republican primary has already started. Please vote. I hope that you will re-elect me to serve you another term. Thank you all.
Thank you. Is David Dahl here from Wiley? Good. You want to come up? All right, no problem.
Thank you. I am not here because I am running for re-election. I am here because of a personal invitation from a very fine young man named Asim. He addressed our city council. He sent me personally an email, which I'm sure he sent everybody else. You know how that copy thing goes. But it touched me. I am a Mormon. I grew up on a playground and I was kicked because I was a Mormon in the United States of America, where we believe in freedom of religion. Most people considered us a cult, even though the name of our church is the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. We are not a cult. We are led by a prophet just as you are. I wanted to come and let Asim and his brother and his mother know that I empathize. And it is my goal to help every one of you feel welcome in the city of Wiley. If you have an issue or concern, please join me and we'll work together. And by the way, we're no longer considered a cult. Mitt Romney kind of helped with that. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm also a candidate.
Sure. Oh, yeah, we weren't done. Yes.
No, we weren't done.
Okay. Oh, yeah, go.
The House District.
Go ahead.
I was wondering if maybe I wasn't on there. I was late RSVP.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
So my name is Kristen Padgett, and I'm also running for the Texas House District 33. Which is the Collin County portion of Frisco, and then all of Rockwall County. So if you find yourself or anybody you know in there, you can definitely cast your ballot for me on March 1st, anytime in early voting. I stand for economic stability, stabilizing our education system, and our civil liberties, which does include religious freedom. Thank you guys so very much.
Do we have Thomas Hayden with us?
Yes.
Oh, very good.
Hello everyone, my name is Thomas Hayden. I'm also running the Republican primary for Collin County Justice of the Peace, Precinct 3, Place 1. And I'd like to take this opportunity to, of course, say that I would appreciate your vote, and I am very thankful for being invited here, but I hope that at the very least you get out and vote and exercise that right, which is one of the most important rights that we have as Americans. So regardless of whether you vote for me, hopefully you will, but if not, at least get out there and vote. And thank you all for coming, and my compliments on the tremendous cake. It was completely.
All right, thank you. The last one I have on my list, Marilyn Hinton from the Plano School District.
Well, I'm not sure why I'm on your list. I'm running.
That's okay. That's all right.
But I will be running next year.
There you go. See? Somehow I knew that.
I'm also running with Nancy Humphrey and Carolyn Mobius, who signed up and could not come today. So I'm representing them as well. And all three of us will be running next year. So I hope you keep that in mind.
All right. Thank you so much. Let's give them all a big hand. Oh, there's another one? Okay. Sure. We have another one?
Yeah. No, I'm John Cox. I'm a candidate for Collin County Commissioner in Precinct 3 on the Republican side. And it's a privilege to be here today. We've had a spirited discussion here at this table about presidential candidates, why this, why that, absence, etc. But it is a privilege to be here today. It's a very special day, and I do sincerely appreciate you for being here. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Earlier, so he's not running for office, but we did want to recognize another distinguished guest that we do have with us. His name is Father Joshua Whitfield. He's from St. Rita Catholic Community. Thank you for being here.
office, running for office.
What's that?
Just checking. So
yeah, yeah. That's what. Are there any others that I've missed? Sultan, one of our volunteers decided to. All right. Yeah, like Judge Chuck just said, I mean, and everybody else said, it is very important to get out to vote. It's coming up. Early voting has already started. All this talking of voting and elections has reminded me of a joke. Some of you may have heard from Bill Vaughn. He said that an American citizen will cross the whole ocean to fight for democracy, but he won't cross the street to vote in a national election. So hopefully we don't want that to be true. We want to do the opposite of what he said. But on that note, yeah, I do encourage all of us here to get the vote out. With that, we'll basically continue the program. We do have a video that we're now going to show. So if we could kindly ask the volunteers to dim the lights. It's just about a 6-minute video. And then we'll have a few speakers after that, and then we'll close. If we could get the lights, please. Okay. All right. So that video may not have been as professional or amazing as Fox News, but let's give them all a big hand to all the volunteers who helped put that together. Brother Oase, our cameraman, Brother Khalil, Brother Ikram, who's in the back, did an amazing job in putting that together, as well as all the volunteers who were part of it. And as a little side note, the background music to that was from Cat Stevens. I don't know if any of you realize that, but Cat Stevens is now known as Yusuf Islam, but that was his background music. Without further ado, we want to continue the program. We have a few speakers who will be speaking just for a few minutes each. Our first speaker, we're very privileged and honored to have with us the mayor of Richardson, Paul Volker. He was appointed to serve as mayor of the city council in May 2015 and has served on the city council since 2013. He has a BA in business administration from William Penn University in Iowa. He's a sales and marketing professional in the IT and communications industry, and has over 30 years of experience in working in the Richardson Telecom District. To list all of his qualifications would take probably another 10 minutes, but let's give a big hand to Mayor Paul Volker.
Thank you. I am the mayor of Richardson. I was honored to hear that EPIC had some roots in Richardson. And anything we as a city can do to help you, trust me, we'll be there. I do appreciate the invitation to come speak here today. Chief, if you could let Harry know, this is not an intent on my part to do an annexation of this particular area. He's out of town. Well, but that's when things happen. Just a little background on myself. He mentioned that I went to William Penn University. I'm a good Catholic boy father. Disappointed my mother tremendously when I went to a Quaker college and ended up marrying a Quaker. So I had a priest, a pastor, and a friend because we got married in a Methodist church. I figured I'd cover all my bases. But it was at William Penn where I learned the true meaning of diversity. And having been raised Catholic, I kind of figured I didn't need a whole lot of lessons in Christianity. So the Quakers are a very interesting group, and I got to study all the major religions. When you go to a small Christian university, you get a minor in theology, so I didn't have a choice. But studying the all the five major religions, taking coursework in them, I had no idea it was going to ground me so well for living in Richardson, Texas, and the North Texas area. Because of our high-tech, highly educated workforce in the telecommunications and broader industry, we have the most diverse, most successful economic powerhouse in the area of Texas, I believe. And I include all the cities in the context of that conversation. I use diversity when I talk to neighborhood associations or business people in the same context. My particular neighborhood, I live a mile and a half from this mosque. I live farther from the Richardson Mosque than I do from the Garland or the Plano Mosque, so I'm known as a Richardson Panhandler. For you that know, that's that little strip of Richardson. I give my city manager a hard time because the sewers in front of my house actually say City of Plano. I was accused of stealing those from the City of Plano, but no, I don't know how they got there. But it was that background that prepared me well to be one of the leaders in the city of Richardson. As I mentioned, I talked to homeowners. My neighborhood, we have 36 homes just a few blocks from here. I have one of every major religion, one of every color. My son grew up not knowing the difference of anyone's particular faith or culture. He celebrates them all. I grew up in a lily white small town in Iowa where there was one black family and one Hispanic family. But I'm so proud of where he got to grow up and to experience. It literally is across the street from me. I have a Hindu next door, a Muslim next door, a Baptist across the street, a Jewish person, and it's an amazing environment to be a part of. When I talk to business leaders, I talk about the diversity of this area. It's important when you hire that you hire from a diverse background. You want people that approach challenges differently. And having a multicultural, diverse background allows you to look at it that way. You want people that work for you to be like your customers so that you understand their challenges. So when you create products and solutions, you're doing that with your customer in mind. And a diverse environment, a diverse world is what we live in. So that's why we brag about the diversity when I'm trying to make major economic development programs work in my city. In Richardson, as was discussed in the film, one of the biggest things we did several years ago was help develop the Interfaith Alliance for Richardson. And I'll have to be honest here, there was a selfish reason as a city we did it. And we were so reminded of it this last Christmas when we had the tornadoes that affected our friends in Garland and Rowlett. We originally just wanted to find out where all the different House of Faiths were. Who were the contacts? How do we get a hold of them? Because we know when there's an emergency like a tornado or another natural disaster, it's the faith-based organizations that we have to rely on. Our first responders are fantastic, the police and fire departments, for that initial engagement. But as our friends in Garland and Rowlett are finding out, this is a multi-month, multi-year challenge that they're facing. And it's organizations like yours and the interaction of organizations within the faith-based community that allow for the healing and the rebuilding to happen in an effective way. So I thank you for that outreach that you do. I want to celebrate with EPIC the word freedom, whether that's the freedom to believe in what you want to, the freedom to gather and assemble, or the freedom to discuss and maybe even disagree. Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you so much, Mayor Volker. Our next speaker is currently the Deputy Mayor Pro Tem in Murphy. He's also a vice president at a company called Market. He has a degree from Harvard in political science and government. We're very proud that he's a local product from right here in Poteet High School in Mesquite, where he was a valedictorian. It's an honor and privilege to have him residing within our community, and I know EPIC is very proud to have him here with us. Please give a big hand to Owais Siddiqui.
Just gonna do this. I think that's a little too high. All right. Assalamu alaikum and peace be with all of you. I want to sincerely thank you all for coming to the East Plano Islamic Center's inauguration event. For me, this center is intended to be a place for outreach and partnership with the broader community. Perhaps most importantly, this center will diligently work to dispel fears and misunderstandings about Islam. This is a place of learning as much as it is a place of worship. In the next few minutes, I'd like to share my experience growing up as an American Muslim, talking a little bit about the current political environment, as well as ending with how I think it's very important for this community to redouble its outreach efforts. So, I consider myself having had the typical American childhood. You know, I learned how to play baseball and played baseball for many years at the local YMCA. I played football, albeit only in middle school because by high school everyone was double my size. But growing up in Mesquite, Texas, it was a blessing. I never felt like I was any different from anybody else. My family and I, we were an integrated part of the community. We were also the only Muslim family that most people knew. And what I'd like to share next is just a personal story, and it involves September the 11th. I remember that day as I was sitting in Spanish class, and I remember us with my peers watching television, watching the events of that day unfold. And I remember feeling such visceral anger to those who did this to my country. That anger turned into a combination of despair when the news reports later revealed that apparently Muslims, or so-called Muslims, were responsible for the tragedy, for that atrocious act. For me, I couldn't fathom how someone would do that in the name of my religion, how someone could pervert the teachings of my religion and justify that act. It did not compute, it didn't make sense, and it still doesn't make sense. My parents were very concerned about the potential backlash we might face. You know, we were only one, the only one that people knew. But we didn't face any backlash. That evening, I remember fielding phone calls from neighbors and friends who were just calling to check up on us. They were asking, "Are you guys okay? Are you all right?" We even had one neighbor, Ray Carpenter, who was a retired US Army veteran, who came to our door. And I remember my mom opening the door, and I remember hearing apprehension in her voice. I was like, "It's just Ray, why is she concerned?" I went up to the door, and in retrospect, we probably shouldn't have been surprised, but Ray showed up to our door armed, and he basically said, "You let me know if anyone tries to bother y'all. I'm right here." You see, that's the America I know, the America where neighbors look out for one another, regardless of your race or religion. And that's why I find the current political environment to be so odd. You know, Muslims are the current outcast group that's in vogue. We've seen the United States fear one minority group or the other throughout its history. Whether it was the Irish, the Japanese, African Americans, or Hispanics, some group has invariably faced derisive rhetoric. While such rhetoric may be politically expedient, we must all be cognizant of the fact that this rhetoric is damaging. It has a cost. Many of our guests here are people of influence, or you're seeking an office of influence. And all I ask of you is that you do not remain indifferent. When you hear of any minority group being painted with a broad brush, please do not be indifferent. Any group that is unfairly stereotyped or unfairly singled out, because in my opinion, that is truly un-American. And I'd just like to end with talking a little bit to the Muslims gathered here today. I want to share how I think it's critically important for us to engage with our communities. The Pew Research Center found that if an American knows or personally knows a Muslim, they tend to generally have a higher opinion of the faith or Islam in general. And I know that when times are tough, it's easy to retreat and retrench back into our own communities. It's easy to be insular, but that's exactly when we must redouble our efforts to do more outreach. So I would challenge you all today to get more involved. Get involved with your local HOAs, your PTAs. Obviously vote, maybe run for election or run for office. But whatever it is you do, get out there. Do what I do. I invite my neighbors over for barbecue. Barbecue creates a bond. Just invite. And just, you know, char some meat. It's great. So let's not let this inauguration event be an end in itself. It should be the beginning of a dialogue and a partnership with the broader community. This building, I don't want it to be one that is feared. This building needs to be an inviting and educational place. You see, people simply fear what they do not know. Right? And that's the job we face. We have to get people to get to know us a bit better. I would just like to leave you with a few words from Harold LeClaire Ickes. He's one of my favorite political figures in history. He was a Secretary of the Interior under FDR. And he asked the question, what constitutes an American? You see, it's not color, nor race, nor religion, not the pedigree of his family or where you were born, nor his social status, nor his bank account, not his trade, nor profession. An American is one who loves justice and believes in the dignity of man. An American is one who will fight for his freedom and that of his neighbor. Let that just be a small reminder. We are all Americans. We're all in the same boat. We might be in choppy and uncharted waters right now, but we are all going to arrive at that destination together as Americans. Thank you.
Thank you, Oase. Those were some beautiful words and beautiful advice. Our final speaker before we have Q&A and wrap up is Dr. Michael Phillips. We were very happy to have him last year as part of our Educator Appreciation Conference, and it's good that we've now continued our relationship with him. Just to quickly give you background, he has a PhD from UT Austin, where he was a researcher at the Center for American History. He also has a degree in journalism, and he used to be a reporter for the Fort Worth Star-Telegram. He is a scholar of Texas race relations and the author of the award-winning book, White Metropolis, Race, Ethnicity, and Religion in Dallas, from 1841 to 2001. Since then, he's written two more books on American history. Please give a rousing welcome to Professor Michael Phillips.
Salaam alaikum. Now, politics has been a theme, and there was a moment at a presidential town hall meeting that I found poignant and in some ways heartbreaking. A man stood up in the audience to ask one of the candidates a question, and he said, "I'm a doctor, I'm a Muslim, and I'm afraid for my children's safety." We've talked about being neighborly, and I am proud of my country. I am proud of the civil rights movement. I'm proud of the great art we've produced, but we are not always neighborly to strangers. And I think when we do that, we fail in our creed, our common creed. Now, my wife, Betsy, a few months ago, it was in November 28th, was reading the newspaper, and she saw a story about a group that called itself the Bureau of American Islamic Relations. And they were visiting a mosque in Irving, and they showed up with their faces covered, and they were carrying guns, and they were shadowing the members of the mosque there. And they were saying, this group is plotting to impose Sharia law. And they, a friend of mine was one, a person who spoke out against Islamophobia at an Irving City Council meeting. And her name was written down, and they looked it up, and her name and other people's names and their home addresses and their phone numbers were posted on the internet. So we saw this, and Betsy said, we should do something. And I said, okay, sounds good. So with my son Dominic, we went on November 28th. We went to the mosque in Irving to make sure that didn't happen again. And we were there, and there was a group space set aside for these, I'll be blunt, these clowns in masks, these bullies, and they didn't show up. There were 200 of us. And here's what I want to say. The people with the guns, intimidating, threatening people for their religion, that's not America. The 200 who protested against them, that was America. It was a beautifully diverse group. And one of the things that really moved me, and one of the things that's always moved me about the Muslim community, they opened up their mosque, and they allowed us to come inside. They offered us food, they offered us a drink, you know, they welcomed us. And I think about not just the generosity of that act, but also the courage, because we know that you are taking a risk in this climate. We remember what happened in Charleston, South Carolina, the Mother Emanuel Church, where they welcomed a white terrorist in, who then murdered members of the church. So I am impressed with that. The message I want to get across, because we did that, and then on December 12th, we showed up at the mosque in Richardson, where the group showed up again. Again, we outnumbered them by a large factor. You know, they had their American flags, we had the American creed, and I'm very proud of what we did. You know, I have to say this, Islamophobia, it's happened in history. We've already had references to this. Of course, the founder of the Mormon religion was assassinated. You know, I grew up Catholic, like others, and, you know, there were, in the colonial period, there were laws against Catholics holding public office. There were laws against Catholics inheriting land. Massachusetts actually had a law they put on the books in 1647, before the Revolution, prescribing the death penalty for any priests they found within the colony. We've done that. We've had political parties have risen to keep immigrants out, to keep Catholics out, the know-nothings in the 1840s. We had a terrible riot in Philadelphia in 1847 against Catholics. And of course, the Jewish population. You know, we had Henry Ford. You know who Henry Ford is? You may know about the automobile, you may not know, he published a newspaper called the Dearborn Independent, in which he said that Jews were plotting to control the world, that they started World War I, and that we needed to keep them out. Charles Coughlin was a priest who was an anti-Semite, who was on the radio in the 1930s, who railed against the influence of Jews and sympathized with Hitler. This is unfortunately a common story in American history. Well, you know what? I think there's good news, though. They're in the minority. The anti-Catholic laws vanished. It was once unthinkable, but the first year of my life, a Catholic was elected president. We have a Catholic vice president. We laid to rest a Catholic Supreme Court justice today. And the Supreme Court today, do you know what the religious makeup of the eight surviving members of the Supreme Court? 5 Catholics, 3 Jews. That would have been unimaginable years ago. This is always with heartache, this is always with pain, but to echo on what our friend just said, we have to know that intolerance, more often than not, withers with familiarity. Prejudice feeds on ignorance, while brotherhood and sisterhood thrives on knowledge. Catholics and Jews in earlier generations became good neighbors. They gave to charity, they donated blood, they fed the hungry, they clothed the naked, they taught, they played, and they defended their country side by side with their non-Catholic, non-Jewish neighbors. In short, they did exactly what good neighbors are supposed to do. And that's exactly what you're doing. And that's what every mosque I've ever visited, that's what you do. You are American by how you live, not by your words. And you melt the hearts of your neighbors with, and you open minds with your hospitality, your generosity, and your kindness. If you'll indulge me, I'll quote the Judeo-Christian Bible. Be strong and be of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. This season of hate shall pass. Your good deeds are changing the world. I want to quote someone who was a hero of mine when I was growing up, Bobby Kennedy. And he made a speech in 1966 in apartheid South Africa. And he faced all kinds of pressure and he spoke to audiences that had black and white members. And he defied the authority. It was a racial dictatorship. And he stood up to them, even though he was the guest. Sometimes, as a guest, sometimes you have to speak the truth. And he said, quote, every time a man stands up for an ideal, or acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope, and crossing each other from a million different centers of energy, and daring those ripples build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance. That's what you're doing with this event today. That's what you're doing with your acts of kindness, many of which aren't noted. They don't make the press, like, you know, the terrorism in Irving and Richardson. But I want to say, I'm speaking for my wife and my son. I want to thank you for this opportunity to share time and break bread. Thank you for all you do to make this a better, more loving community. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Phillips. In fact, I would say let's give a big round of applause to all three of our guests. They were wonderful speakers. Really benefited a lot from those presentations. Thank you so much. We just have a few minutes left, so we did want to leave a few minutes for question and answer, and then we'll wrap up the program. So for the question and answer, basically we'll keep it informal. Just please raise your hand, and state who you would like to address your question to, and we'll take the next few minutes to address those if you have any. Any questions and answers for either or any of our speakers or even regarding our facility or our organization? Everybody's shy, it's like a church. Yes, go ahead.
So you mentioned your medical clinic and some of your other community services. Those
yes.
of us who might like to help out if we could as volunteers, might there be an opportunity?
I think there would, yeah. And as, like Brother Khalil said earlier, the clinic is something, I think as you all drove in, did you see the facility that faces the street? There was a sign that said Murphy Pediatrics. We're basically going to be converting that to a facility that will be open for the public. And the board has taken a courageous decision on that. And so, yeah, that now that we have a much bigger facility, I think we will have more room for volunteers. Not just there, but in other programs as well. Because like he said, we're trying to expand our other outreach and interfaith and humanitarian projects, so sure. If you could leave us, I think we already have Professor Phillips' information, but if anybody else would like to help out in any way, then please leave us your contact information and we'd be glad to follow up. Thank you. Any other questions? Boy, silent crowd. All right. So if there aren't, oh, go ahead. Yes, go ahead.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank all the guests who came over here with the time. The question I have is for the EPIC management and the community at large. You see an event here of interfaith, but most of the people here are adults and grown-ups. And the feelings of respect, the cohesiveness starts at a very young age. We have a youth outreach program, young program, but is there anything being done either by the community or all the people who are trying for an office or otherwise to generate these feelings at a very early age, even as early as elementary or middle school? So I would actually, this is a question for all, so anybody would like to answer, please. Thank you.
Does anybody in particular want to say? Okay. Marilyn, like to say, yes.
I'm on the board with the Plano ISD School Board. Have we addressed this exact question? Marilyn.
Maybe come up, yeah, because I think they can't hear this. Sorry.
I'm with the Plano ISD School Board.
Now we turned it
off. And now we have to turn it on. Okay. I'm with the Plano ISD School Board, and I do want to let you know that we have had some problems in the school district, especially with bullying and other problems of that sort. And I've had to personally come and address some of them myself. But I want you to know that the school district is working extremely hard to make all of our children get along. We have 93 languages that we speak in the school district at this point, and I think Richardson probably has close to that as well. And I just want you to know that the school district tries to stay on top of it. We are absolutely, you know, committed to making all of our children get along. We have character education programs that are in place. I was on a national board of character education myself. And so we are actively and completely dedicated to helping all of the students. But I do want you to know that I really need the community to come forth and let us know things. I have realized that sometimes people don't say things because they don't want to make waves or they don't want to incriminate their children or make it any worse. But the most important thing you can do is to please let the school board know when anything is happening, and we'll take care of it right away. Promise.
There we go. The school districts do an absolutely wonderful job. One of the nice things about living in Richardson is I get to brag about both Plano's schools, which, by the way, I'm in Collin County, so I'm part of the Plano School District and the Richardson School District. And my wife, who is an ESL teacher. Yes, there are over 90 plus languages also spoken in Richardson too. A couple of quick things on youth though, and engaging the community. I mentioned the Richardson Interfaith Alliance. One of the programs it has is a youth alliance. And we just had our big annual meeting, and it was beautiful to see all the kids from the Interfaith Alliance get together and celebrate faith together. It was actually one of the most moving moments. So I would encourage you in your interfaith groups to also launch programs for the youth. And if this, here's my plug, if you feel free to join the Richardson Interfaith Alliance also, I think you'd find it good. But from a broader community outreach too, I think there are some wonderful programs that I encourage you to get involved with. Leadership, Plano Leadership, Richardson are two very, very good organizations. They also have youth-based organizations assigned to them, and that's oftentimes where we get those future leaders from. So as you look at the political landscape and maybe not necessarily like what you see, please get involved. Take those leadership classes. Become engaged at the earliest point in your life as possible. Encourage your young ones to do the same thing. I think you'll be really proud of them and proud of the results that come from that. Thanks.
Thank you. Sure, go ahead.
We have a question up
for that. I am not here speaking as a representative of the city of Wylie. I am a Rotarian. And some of you know what that is, some of you don't. The Rotary Club is an international organization. Our motto is service before self. We have a high school group in Wylie East High School. We are attempting to get them formed in the Wylie High School. We will welcome Plano East High School. They are in our close area. And we would suggest for Plano and Richardson that you encourage your Rotarians to reach out to the high school students. From my own experience, I will tell you as young people and tell you as parents of young people, the one speaker who mentioned that those who know a Muslim trust them and they don't bully their own, their friends. That is the key to conquering this is in the next generation. Let them join Boy Scout groups. Let them join Rotary affiliates. The Boy Scouts of America, all they have to do to be a member is believe in God, Allah. They have to show allegiance to their country and to their fellow men. It doesn't mean Christian. It doesn't mean Jewish. That will protect them more than community organizations, school districts, etc., trying to talk on behalf of bullying. And just a plug for the Wylie East Interact, they are building a 2-unit townhouse for Habitat for Humanity. As youth, they're doing this, and it was their choice of a project. If you would like your youth involved in that kind of thing, I suggest that is the best answer to your question.
Thank you. Thank you. Is that a separate question? Or
no, just same thing. So I just want to respond to echo what was just said, right? So Boy Scout, I'm the assistant cup master for the Boy Scouts that we host here in our another organization, Muslim American Society, right? And that's a very reason for us to engage in this. We have about 60 Cub Scouts, and we have a big pack of Scouts also, who's aligning, and this is what it is. Scouts is about knowing, you know, believing in your faith, and believing in the oath for the country, that how do we support it. So I encourage all the parents of the community to, from that age, participate in that program, and be part of the community, right?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. So I'd just like to comment that I'm as a student of Plano ISD, I just am amazed how wonderfully diverse the entire student body is. I have students from pretty much all, I have friends from all over the world, China, Israel, India, Sweden, even Ghana. it's just amazing how wonderfully diverse it is, and I think that that's just and also how this area, the North Texas area, has so much international input. Like almost all the major religions you can find places of worship are all around the area, and that's a wonderful thing about this place.
By the way, that's my son, and he's who I'm very proud of him, and he's like Tom Joad in The Grapes of Wrath. Wherever there's a bully, he's willing to stand up to them. So good for him. Real quickly, I'm the assistant faculty advisor for the Muslim Students Association at Collin College, the campus on Spring Creek, and we make it a focus to reach out to the larger community. A few years ago, we did a panel on Muslim women in America. We had something like 220 people show up, and people were startled who were non-Muslims because they had stereotypes of Muslim women, and we had a panel of women wearing the hijab, talking about their lives. We had a convert who was a Southern Baptist who had become a Muslim woman, and it was amazing. They were lined up for 40 minutes. They were talking to these women. They were really fascinating. We've done other sessions. We were doing meet the candidate forums at with the Muslim students group, and it's working. His age group is going to be a lot different than ours, because I grew up. It was 20 years after the Brown versus Board of Education when I was in high school. Our school was still segregated. Those days are over. So have faith in them, because they really are a force for change. Thank you.
Thank you so much for all those responses. I think that question and all the responses was a perfect segue to the fact that, or what we wanted this event to be, because I think it's a stepping stone for establishing, future collaborations with other individuals and other organizations, and that's exactly what we wanted. So we hope to stay in touch in the future. We have your contact information. If you don't, then please let us know, because like Away said, we don't just want this to be a nice lunch and just run off, right? We want it to be a stepping stone for future programs. I don't think we have time for other questions at this point. Did you have a question or come on?
Another question.
Okay.
So I wanted to address this question to Mayor Volker and Chief Gushing. As we know, so much vitriol is coming from Washington, or at least the election campaign, and particularly from one campaign. At the city level, at the law enforcement level, is there anything you have put in place to deal with any backlash against the community that might result from these bigoted statements that are coming out?
So the question had to do with the bigoted environment we have, and at the local level, given some of the rhetoric that's going on at the highest level of politics right now, are there any things we're doing? So obviously things like this are important. I was this morning, I didn't talk about it in my speech because I didn't want to take anything from Epic, but I was also meeting at the Richardson Mosque with the board, and their questions to me were specifically political, and I answered them as a friend, not as the mayor of Richardson, in how to get involved, how to participate, how to let your voice be heard. They asked me opinions about particular candidates, and I'm not going to share them right now, but I think I sense a vibe in here. Things at the local level, I'm sure the chief can speak to it. It was referenced that we had a couple of times in Richardson situations at the mosque. I can't go into the detail of how we protect our friends, but trust me, we do. When the bullies were out front, I was in the office with the board, with the imam, and with a few of my SWAT friends. We will protect, we will serve, and we will respect. That's all I can say.
Go ahead.
Well, good afternoon. The police department's job is to maintain a safe environment so citizens can have a good quality of life. That's what our job is. That's what we're paid to do. And we think we've done a very good job in Plano. We have a great citizenry. We have one of the safest city in the state of Texas, over 200,000 when you look at our crime rates. But anytime a crime occurs, though, the victims don't care about whether or not we have great statistics or we have low crime and happen to them. We want to make sure that we do all that we can, particularly the community outreach, to build as strong a community as possible, citizens respecting one another, doing some of the things we heard today the professor talked about and others. And you know, we've also seen some very difficult times for law enforcement recently. Some of the minority communities have had some issues with certain law enforcement segments across the country. You've seen it in the media. And I think that whenever you look at those places that have those problems, you see one thing in common, that they don't have the trust and respect to the degree they need to have with their community. When something bad happens, it's very difficult for those communities. And speaking of painting people with broad brushes, unfortunately, sometimes people do that with law enforcement. You know, sometimes I think the least of our brothers are the ones that hurt us the most, those law enforcement agencies across the country that maybe don't have the same standards that we do, that don't have the same hiring practices, that their officers go out and do something that embarrasses our profession. And you can be sure that we're as embarrassed as anyone else when those things do happen. We hate to see those happen. But here in Plano, you know, we do all that we can to build that trust and credibility. We have a great community. We have one of the safest communities. And I think we just have to work together to make sure we respect one another and make our job a lot easier as well. So thank you.
Thank you all again so much for all these wonderful responses and this wonderful event. I apologize that we do have to break for prayer. As you may know, Muslims have 5 daily prayers and we're about to start one of our prayers. But as Prophet Muhammad has advised us, he said that whoever does not thank people does not thank God. So we're here to thank all of you. You have honored us with your presence and we're going to be breaking for prayer. If you want to, you know, this discussion could go on for hours, but if you would like to mingle with anybody afterwards, you're free to do so. If any of you want to stay and observe the prayer downstairs, we have volunteers who could take you down and have you observe the prayer. Otherwise, we thank you for attending and we hope to have such events in the future. Appreciate it. Thank you.